Hey everyone, Bill Lethman here for Money Evolution. In this video, I'm going to be talking about 11 of the biggest 401k mistakes that I see people making all the time. So if you're in a 401k plan or another employer-sponsored retirement program, you're going to want to really pay attention to the content that I have in today's video. But real quick though, before I get into the video, if you're watching this and you have some questions or you'd like to learn a little bit more about what we do at Money Evolution, you can go to wealthvisionplan.com to learn about our comprehensive financial planning and also our Retirement Time Machine online retirement planning course. You can go to retirementtimemachine.com or we've got some links down in the description below. Number one is going to be not getting started early with your 401k investing. So let's take a hypothetical example. Let's say we have a 25-year-old that begins putting $5,000 a year into their 401k plan. And let's say they just keep it at that $5,000 for a total of 40 years. And when they get to be age 65, if they were able to earn, let's say, a 7% compounded rate of return, that $5,000 annual contribution for 40 years would grow to nearly $1 million at $998,175. Now let's take another situation. Let's say that we have somebody that doesn't get started until they're 30. So they just miss out on 5 years compared to that first example. But they contribute the same $5,000 every year, earn the same 7% compounding for 35 years instead of 40 years. They have just $691,000. Now, still a lot of money, but over $300,000 less than that person that started just 5 years earlier. So if you haven't gotten started with a 401k plan, or you know somebody that's maybe a younger individual that hasn't gotten started with their 401k, you have to encourage people to get started early. Also, too, you may be having opportunities where you can increase that savings over time. And there's always going to be something else that you want to do with that money, some other purpose for it. But I can tell you that the earlier that you can get those contributions in, the earlier you can increase those contributions over time, I think the better off you're going to be for your retirement. Number two is going to be missing out on company match. So we just talked about the benefits of starting even just 5 years earlier. But let's say your employer is also matching those contributions. Basically, that's free money that you're leaving on the table by not putting that money into your 401k plan. So if you have a company match option, it's going to be very important for you to understand what that match is and how much you have to contribute to at least get that maximum amount of matching contribution. So for example, they may tell you that you get 50 cents on the dollar up to the first 5% of your contributions. So you're going to want to make sure that you're at least contributing that 5% so you don't leave any of that company match on the table. And then when you add that into that first scenario we just talked about, that's going to have a bigger impact on what those benefits are going to be long term. So missing out on company match is going to be a big deal, and you don't want to make that mistake. The third mistake is thinking your 401k plan is free. And it's always amazing to me to learn how many people actually think they're not paying any fees at all inside their 401k plan. In fact, in a recent CNBC article, they actually said that over a third of 401k participants actually believe they're not paying any fees at all inside their 401k plan. Maybe they think their company's picking up the tab for that. Well, that couldn't be further from the truth. In that same article, they actually said that the average 401k participant's actually paying about 0.45% per year in fees. And that's going to be just an average. So it's going to depend a lot on the size of your 401k plan or the company that you may be working for and how many people they have participating in the 401k plan. Basically, the larger the company, the larger the plan, the lower those fees are going to be. But the smaller the plan, if you work for a small business or small company, those fees can actually be quite a bit higher. So the range actually goes from 0.37% for some of the largest 401k plans to as much as 1.42% for some of the larger 401k plans. So that's going to be very important to understand what those fees are, especially if you end up separating service and deciding what to do with that 401k plan after you leave. Should you leave it there or should you move it someplace else, roll it to a new plan, roll it to an IRA account, because those fees are going to be very meaningful for that. Also, to keep in mind for fees, it's going to depend, of course, on the type of investment as well. So things like smaller company mutual funds or international funds, those are going to tend to have a little bit higher fees than some of the other maybe index-based funds and things like that. Now, fees aren't the only thing to consider when looking at 401k options, but understand that you are paying some fees, even if it may not be completely apparent to what those fees are, maybe looking at your statement. But those funds and those different investment options are definitely going to carry some expenses with them. The fourth mistake we see people making is not shifting to a more conservative asset allocation as you get closer to retirement. So when you're in growth mode, when you're a younger investor and you still have 10, 15, 20 years plus to let that money grow and invest and kind of work through some of the ups and downs of the market, plus you're also making contributions to those accounts as well. So when the markets are down, you tend to be buying more shares and more ownership in those specific investments versus when the market may be higher when you're buying fewer shares of that. So it's kind of like a dollar cost averaging thing. But as you get closer to retirement, you're going to want to really start to think about what your retirement cash flow needs are going to be. In other words, how much might you have to take out of that 401k plan to meet some of your spending goals? And consider this. If we look back at the last major market downturn, basically the stock market peaked in 2007 with the S&P 500, and then it fell to its lowest level in March of 2009. And from that peak down to the bottom, the S&P 500 fell 57%. So consider this. Let's say you had $2 million in your 401k plan. Maybe for better or worse, you had it all 100% in that S&P 500 fund in October of 2007. By the time the market finally bottomed, that $2 million would go down to about $860,000. Now, it probably doesn't make sense for almost anybody to have 100% of their portfolio in the S&P 500. But just as an example, if you have a lot of ownership in those growth or equity style investing, stocks and index funds and things like that, if the market does go through a downturn, especially if that downturn occurs close to your retirement date, it could significantly impact your ability to meet some of your retirement planning goals. So something we talk about in a lot of the other videos is building some cash flow buckets and sort of a buffer so that you have some cash reserves and maybe some safer investments and things like that that can be drawn upon for some of that spending so that if the market does go through a downturn, you're not having to sell things at a loss. Number five is going to be rolling over your 401k. Now, there obviously could be a lot of very good reasons to roll over your 401k plan into an IRA account, but there's also two very big reasons why that may not be a very good idea, why it could potentially be a very big mistake if, in fact, you fall into one of these two categories. So one of those is going to be related to something called the age 55 rule. And basically, that says that if you separate service in the year you reach age 55 or later, but you're not yet 59 and a half, you can actually take penalty-free withdrawals from your 401k or your employer-sponsored retirement plan and not have to pay that 10% penalty that normally would apply. If you roll that money over to an IRA account, that would not be the case. If you're not yet 59 and a half, you would potentially have that 10% penalty. So that's one very good reason to not roll over your 401k plan. Now, the other reason would be something related to something we call the backdoor Roth IRA strategy. And this is something we've talked about in other videos. So let's say you want to make a contribution to a Roth IRA account, but your income is actually too high. You're over that IRS limit. So what you can do potentially is you can make a non-deductible contribution to a traditional IRA account and then immediately convert that IRA to a Roth account. If that's your only IRA account that exists, that works very seamlessly. There's a pretty simple transaction. If you put $7,000 into your traditional IRA account, you've already paid taxes on that. And if that's your only IRA, you can then convert that $7,000 over to a Roth and you wouldn't pay any taxes on it. Now you've kind of used this backdoor method to get some money into a Roth. If you have other money that's in IRA accounts, it could be in a completely separate account. Now something called the pro rata rules are going to come into effect here. And now they're going to look at all of your IRA money collectively, which might include that $7,000 after-tax contribution to that traditional retirement account, but it also may include another $30,000 or $100,000 or whatever that may be of pre-tax contributions. So they're going to look at that collectively, and really without getting into all the details, it just kind of muddy the waters a lot, and it's really not going to accomplish what you want. So by keeping the money at a 401k plan means that you don't have any IRA accounts, if that's the situation that you have, if you don't have any others, then you can potentially do this backdoor strategy. If you roll it over, now that kind of goes completely out the window. So backdoor Roth and also the age 55 rule are two reasons why you may not want to roll over your 401k to an IRA. Number six is contributing to the wrong tax type. So most 401k plans offer two general areas that you can contribute that money to your 401k, the Roth bucket and the traditional bucket. Now, the traditional bucket is that bucket that basically reduces your taxable income as that money goes in. So if you put $20,000 into your 401k into the traditional bucket, it's actually going to lower your taxable income by that $20,000. That money then grows tax deferred, and whatever that grows to, as you start to pull that money out, you're going to be paying taxes on that at your ordinary income tax rate at whatever that may be out into the future. With the Roth bucket, you're actually not getting any tax benefit going in, but that money is then going to grow tax-free to whatever that grows to. So then when you pull that money out in retirement, it's going to be completely tax-free, assuming that it's a qualified distribution. So it's going to be very important for you to understand where your tax bracket is today versus where you think that tax bracket is going to be in the future. Now, I think the big myth or the mistake that I think a lot of people made is that when we first started putting money into these retirement accounts way back 20, 30, 40 years ago, we were kind of led to believe that we'll take that tax deduction today, reduce our taxable income, and then we'll take that money back out and pay taxes at a lower tax rate in retirement because we won't be working anymore. Well, I think for a lot of people, that may not necessarily be the case. We're finding that a lot of people might actually be in a higher tax bracket in the future, and especially too with what we have today in 2023, we have the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act rates, which are pretty much across the board, lower tax rates for almost every tax category versus what they were just a few years ago back in 2017. Well, that Tax Cuts and Jobs Act rate is going to actually expire at the end of 2025, and then we're going to revert back to what are going to potentially be some higher tax rates, not to mention what other tax legislation may be coming down the road as well. So you're going to want to understand where your tax rate is today versus where you're going to be in the future. And effectively, if you're in a lower tax bracket today than what you think you're going to be in the future, then it may make sense to put that money into a Roth and basically forego some of those immediate tax benefits for the long-term benefit of being able to take that money out tax-free later. And if the opposite is true, if we think we're in a higher tax bracket today, then we may want to take and put that money into traditional retirement accounts and pay the taxes later when we might be in a lower tax rate. So that's something that's very important to kind of map out. That's actually one of the things we do as part of our comprehensive financial planning, is really help people understand where their tax rates are today versus where they might be in the future. Number seven is forgetting about old 401k plans. So if you're somebody that's changed jobs, and maybe you've changed jobs multiple times over the years, and you've contributed to a number of different 401k plans, maybe you've left some of those 401k plans behind. Maybe it's still at your old company. And now that you're contributing money to a new 401k plan, that becomes the thing that you're really paying attention to. So these old 401k plans oftentimes can kind of get neglected. Maybe you're not really paying attention to the asset allocation. Maybe it's not performing very well. Well, getting a handle on those old 401k plans and really kind of diving into them, seeing how are they doing? How are they doing compared to my new plan? Are there some better options out there? But really just having multiple accounts starts to get really cumbersome to keep track of. So one of the things that I would recommend is looking at if it makes sense to consolidate some of those old 401k plans together. So we talked about some reasons not to roll over your 401k plan, but if you have a new 401k and that old 401k plan is able to transfer into that, you could actually roll an old 401k plan into your new 401k plan. So that could be something that could work out for a lot of people, especially if it's a little bit lower balance or you really like your current 401k. And of course, the other option would be to roll that old 401k plan over to an IRA account. Now, that's probably going to give you the most flexibility and the most options for investing and everything. But again, there could be a couple reasons why that may not make sense to do that. If you're trying to do the backdoor Roth strategy, or you did separate service after age 55, but you're not 59 and a half yet. We just talked about that. But basically consolidating some of those old 401k plans, or at least paying attention to them, kind of doing a review of that and making sure they're performing and doing what it is that you want them to do. So number eight is going to be cashing out a 401k plan early. And this is something that kind of goes along with that last one, some of those old 401k plans that may not have really large balances. Something that apparently is very common is that when people change jobs from one company to another, if they only have a few thousand dollars or $5,000 or even $10,000, a lot of times people just say, hey, you know what? It's not very much money. I'm just going to cash it out. I've got some projects at the house that I want to do or some fun stuff I want to do with that money instead of saving that money for retirement. And they don't really think think about the long-term impact of that account and what that could potentially grow to over a long period of time. So it's very common for a lot of those smaller 401k plans to just simply get cashed out. Well, if you're not 59 and a half yet, well, that could be obviously taxes, but also a 10% early withdrawal penalty. Plus, you no longer have that money saved for your retirement, and it's very hard to catch up from that. So cashing out an old 401k plan is probably not the best thing to do, especially in light of some of the penalties and the taxes. Number nine is going to be missing out on some special features that your 401k plan may have available to you, but maybe you don't know about. And I think a lot of 401k plans are actually going to have these options available to them, but of course not all of them will. So one of those is going to be something called the after-tax savings option that you might have available to you inside your 401k. So as I'm sure you probably know, there's some upper thresholds or upper contribution limits for how much money can go into your 401k plan, either into that Roth bucket or the traditional bucket. And for 2023, that number is going to be $22,500 if you're under the age of 50. And if you're 50 years old or older, that number jumps up by $7,500 to $30,000 for how much money you can contribute. But did you know the IRS actually has an upper limit for how much total money can go into that 401k plan? And so for 2023, if you're under the age of 50, that number is $66,000. And if you're 50 years old or older, that number jumps up to $73,500. And so that's the total amount of money that can go into that. And that's going to be comprised of three things primarily. One, it's going to be comprised of those actual contributions you're putting into either the Roth or the traditional. And again, that number, if it's $22,500, if you're under the age of 50, that's a combined total. So you don't get $22,500 Roth and another $22,500 traditional. That's going to be however you want to break that up, 100% to one or the other, or splitting it somehow in there. So that's going to be one component of that. If your company is matching any contributions, that's going to be an additional component to it. And then whatever that gap is left over, you could potentially put that money into an after-tax savings bucket if your company allows. And also, your company may have some restrictions on how much money could go into that. So for example, if you were looking at somebody under the age of 50, $66,000 is that total number. And if you're contributing the maximum amount to that, that account, the traditional bucket or the Roth bucket, that $22,500, that leaves an additional $43,500 of additional contribution. So if your company's contributing, let's say, $10,000 in terms of a match, that could mean you could contribute an additional $33,500 to that account. And the same thing would be true for somebody that's 50 years old or older. But again, that number is going to be $7,500 higher. So $73,500. If you're totally maximizing that $30,000 contribution, that gives you $43,500 left over. And the same thing, if you're getting a match, that's going to reduce that a little bit. And then you'd be able to put that additional money into that after-tax bucket. So why is this kind of a big deal? Well, it used to never really be too big of a deal. But then in 2014, the IRS kind of made a ruling and clarified what was previously a very gray area. And that 2014 ruling actually says now you can take that after-tax bucket and then you can roll that money over directly to a Roth IRA account, or you can do it as an in-plan conversion and roll it from that after-tax bucket to your Roth bucket within your 401k plan, and it's a completely non-taxable event. So sometimes we call this the mega backdoor Roth strategy because it allows you to put, again, potentially, you know, $40,000 or so into that after-tax bucket and get that Roth account really supercharged if you're in a position where you want to be saving more money for retirement. So that 2014 ruling kind of changed the whole game on that. Now, the second special feature that you may have available to you inside your 401k is something called the self-directed option. So if you're looking at your 401k plan and maybe you're looking at that menu of investment options, maybe it's a very small menu. Maybe there's not very many choices there, or you're not really overly crazy about some of the options that you have there. Some 401k plans allow you to set up the self-directed account within your 401k plan. So it kind of becomes an account within an account, and then you can transfer money from that core menu of investment options over to the self-directed account. Now, this is something I think more for some advanced investors, some people that are really paying attention to the market or really kind of know what they're looking for when it comes to some of these investments. All 401k plans are going to be a little bit different when it comes to this in terms of what they're going to allow inside that self-directed bucket, but it could allow you to buy individual stocks other than your company stock. So if you want to buy some shares of a company that you've been following or you like, you might be able to do that inside the self-directed option. You may be able to buy other your mutual funds that are not on that menu. So if you have some funds that you like, it also may allow you to buy exchange-traded funds, something very common with a lot of 401k plans. And all of them are going to be a little bit different. Some of them allow you to buy mutual funds, but not stocks. Some of them allow you to buy stocks, but not mutual funds. It's, again, going to depend a lot on how your plan was set up. But that self-directed option is going to potentially give you some other choices and some ability to diversify away from that core menu. Mistake number 10 is going to relate to what we were just talking about a minute ago with that after-tax bucket that you might have inside your 401k plan. And we've seen this a lot over the years where people have built up these balances inside these after-tax accounts inside their 401k plan, and maybe they don't really understand how that money got there. Maybe they don't even really understand that they have that money, and they maybe don't understand that there's some options that they have for moving some of that money over to a Roth IRA, or if you're doing an in-plan Roth conversion, doing it to a Roth 401k plan. So let's take an example. Let's say that you've contributed $50,000 to a after-tax account. That's money you've already paid taxes on, and you've had that invested for a number of years, and maybe you've gotten a little bit of growth on that account. So that $50,000 account has now grown to $80,000. So you have an $80,000 account, $50,000 of it's money that's already been taxed, and $30,000 of it is going to be part of that other tax-deferred type of money like you have in other traditional buckets. So what you can do potentially is you can do a conversion, and you can convert that $50,000 over to a Roth IRA, or do an in-plan conversion if your plan allows it, to a Roth 401k plan, and that would be a completely non-taxable event. And what you've done is you've just moved over that chunk of money, that $50,000 in this example, over to a Roth IRA, and if that money continues to grow, hopefully, now all of that growth is going to be completely tax-free. And then that $30,000 that you have will just be categorized as the other money that you have in those traditional buckets. So if you have money in after tax, or you're doing this on an annual basis, you want to be moving that money over periodically into that Roth account, either through the in-plan Roth conversion or rolling it out to a Roth IRA. Mistake number 11 is related to target date funds that you may be investing in or that you might have available to you within your 401k plan. Now, according to Morningstar, as many as 98% of all 401k plans offer at least some target date funds to their plan participants. And according to Vanguard, as many as 80% of those plan participants have at least some of their money invested in these target date funds. So they're very, very popular investments. And I think originally they were set up as sort of a set it and forget it sort of investment strategy. And the idea is that you choose a target date that's very close to around the age when you're planning to retire. And then that target date fund actually shifts the portfolio to be a little bit more conservative as you get closer to that date. Well, one mistake I think people make is thinking that those target date funds are actually guaranteed. And so even though those funds are going to be moving a little bit more conservatively as they get closer to retirement, they are by no means guaranteed investments. In fact, last year in 2022, we saw some of the worst performance for some of those target date funds, even those target date funds where they have a very close target date, where they're very close to retirement. And that's because not only did stocks perform poorly last year, but bonds performed poorly as well. So as we get closer to retirement, those target date funds are going to shift money from stocks to bonds. And again, 2022 was not only a bad year for stocks, but it was also a very bad year for bonds. So again, don't assume that money you have invested in that target date fund is going to be guaranteed. Now, I think another mistake sometimes people make when it comes to these target date funds is not really understanding the asset allocation within that target date fund. So let's say, for example, you're a younger investor and you've got over 30 years before you retire. You may find that target date fund is actually invested a lot more conservatively than you'd really like to be. The same token, you might be maybe only 10 or 15 years away from retirement, and maybe that's invested a little bit more aggressively than you want to be. You're actually a little bit more conservative investor. So you want to really understand and get into the details and understand how much of your money is actually going to stocks, how much is going to bonds, how much is going to international or whatever all those other categories are, and really make sure that's in line with what your goals and risk tolerance are. Another thing to think about is that there could be a lot of difference between one target date fund from one company versus another target date fund of the same year from another company. So let's say you've got money invested in the 2035 target date fund, and maybe your spouse works for a different company and they also have a 2035 target date fund. You may find that yours has 70% stocks, but your spouse's only has 60% invested in stocks. So you really want to get into those details. And I think that's one of the things that I don't tend to like about target date funds, is because you kind of lose a little bit of that clarity. And as you become a little bit more educated and a little bit more sophisticated as an investor, you may want to take on more control of what that direction is for your own asset allocation. And then one last thing as it relates to these target date funds, as you go into retirement and start needing to take some withdrawals from the portfolio, those target date funds, in my opinion, are really not going to be the best option for taking those withdrawals. Because if you think about it, a target date fund is really going to be an asset allocation. And even though it is going to get a little bit more conservative as you get closer to that retirement target date, it is still going to have some money that's going to be in stocks, it's going to have some money in bonds, it's going to have some money in international, and it's going to have that whole mix of investments. And so if you get into a point where you want to start taking withdrawals from your account and you start taking out $10,000 or $20,000 from that target date, you're actually going to be selling a little bit of all of that stuff. You're going to be selling a little bit of your stocks, a little bit of your bonds, a little bit of your international, and that may not necessarily be the best approach. One of the things that we recommend as clients go into retirement is building a bucket strategy and having a cash reserve bucket that has about 2 years of cash flow needs in bucket number one, so that you can take those withdrawals from that account without having to sell stocks or investments that may be going up and down in value. Additionally, we may want to have a second bucket that's going to have another 3 to 5 years of cash flow needs in something that's going to be maybe some short-term CDs or short-term bonds, and that's going to be something that's going to give us some opportunity for some of that stuff to mature and refill bucket number one. And then bucket number three would be our growth bucket, and that's going to be what's designed to grow and hopefully keep up with inflation and then give us a little bit of a buffer so that if that stuff happens to be down in value, we've got bucket one and bucket two to draw from and not have to sell some of those equity investments. But again, if you have all that money in a target date fund, as you start to liquidate that portfolio, you're actually going to be selling a little bit of all of that instead of having that buffered approach that we like to talk about there. So anyway, those were 11 of the mistakes that we typically see when it comes to 401k investing. I hope that you got some great information out of it. If you'd like to learn a little bit more about what we do at Money Evolution, be sure to check out some of those links below. And if you haven't already, be sure to subscribe to our channel and also hit that little notification bell as well. It's a great way to get our videos out to more people and a bigger audience. So again, I thank you for watching the video, and I look forward to seeing you soon. Thanks.